Wide angle time. Hey, it's Fran in the lab. Got some lens flare going here, right there. Still don't have the lighting set up here, but yeah, well, it's gonna have to do. Anyway, this is my Lou Reed story. Back in 2000, I was working for Electro-Harmonics, and we got a call, and I was told to go deliver some pedals, and that I was going to go to Lou Reed's studio, and had a big crate of pedals, went with a coworker, and because I was the head tech, I was supposed to help them set up the pedals, deal with any problems, answer any questions, and everything. We were there for hours. And it was this place, it's kind of hard to remember exactly where it was somewhere in Hell's Kitchen, like way, way west side, like west of 10th Avenue. It was like in the really weird industrial area of like West Manhattan. And it was this huge space he had rented. It was like this huge studio. It's like the size of a small nightclub. It's actually like this whole room was about the size of like the old Maxwell's Club. People remember what that was like. And he had a stage built in this room, or there was a stage built in the room, and the whole band was set up on it. They're all spread out. It wasn't cramped. It was like really huge. So everything was set up there on this stage, and the production crew was, they had their, like their own room and a booth and everything. So it was sort of like a touring, like you know, setup in a room. And on the stage, in the center of the stage, he had this throne. It was this like this sort of like a antique, like archaic kind of chair, like a throne, all kind of gnarled and everything, like right there in the middle of the stage. And right next to it, he had this antique cigar stand, and with a really big stogie in it that he kept lit all the time and kept puffing on it. And so we came in and showed him the pedals. He was playing around with them, you know, I'd set them up, he'd play with the knobs and everything, they'd run it through. I mean, we were there for hours just trying out all these pedals, and in the course of doing all the business and everything, I told him that I had a pedal too that I had tinkered together, and I had brought it with me. And it was a prototype, something I was calling the Sweet. It was a germanium fuzz tone. And he wanted to try it, and so I set it up and let him play it. And he was actually, Lou Reed was actually the first musician other than myself to ever play the Sweet, the original prototype. In fact, this is the one. This is the one he played right here. This is the prototype. Yeah. It's got a paper label on it. Paper label, but this is the pedal that he actually played. So he loved the pedal. He wanted to have it. He's like, yeah. He says, oh, I want to have this pedal. I was like, oh, it's mine, you know. And it's like, I'm not going to give you this pedal. It's the prototype. It's the only one. There's no others. So I was like, well, can you make me one? I was like, well, you know, I could make you one. You know, I won't make it for free, but you know. But he had his guy. One of his guys kept calling me and wanting this pedal. I was like, well, no, I'm not going to give you the pedal. I was like, well, you know, Lou wants a Sweet. He wants a Sweet. And I was like, well, I'll make a Sweet, but, you know, parts and labor, it won't be free. I was like, well, you know, and I was like, you really want me to just hand you a free Sweet? And he was like, yeah. I was like, no, I'm not going to do that. So, so Lou never got a Sweet of his own. So, you know, but he was the first to try it out, and he gave it double thumbs up, so I ended up, you know, investing to crank some out, and ended up being the first pedal that I produced at the new Frantone factory in 2001, so. So there we go. That was Lou Reed's contribution to Frantone, and I this week, of course, I did the Sweet Jane cover, and I'm thinking about Lou Reed a lot, and I gotta tell you, he was very courteous and very polite to us, and he very quiet-spoken guy, unassuming guy, but he definitely had this idiom. He was not timid. I mean, And you have to understand, I have met a lot of famous people and hung out in a lot of backstage areas, a lot of rehearsal spaces, with a lot of famous rock stars over the decades. And all of them, they all have their own sort of space. There's, you know, they have their crowd around them, their sort of their clique, and they all have the sort of air about them. But Lou Reed, he really had an idiom. I don't really know how to explain it, but it's like he was the unquestioned king of his domain, and the people around him just had this. He was the king on the throne, and you were in the throne room, you know, and so he really did have that sort of presence. So it's you can sort of wonder whether it was whether Lou Reed was a rock star because he had this presence about him, or if he had the presence about him because he was a rock star, or both. but yeah, he was a real deal, and so definitely been thinking about Lou Reed this week, and that is my Lou Reed story, and these are my gray hairs, which I have been growing out. You know, it's kind of a sad story, you know, all this death, but my hairdresser of 34 years, Florence, she passed away this summer, and no one else had ever done my hair but Florence my whole life, like since I was a teenager, you know, before transition and everything, and she was there for the whole thing. So, you know, I really didn't really just want to get another hairdresser. And I'd been dyeing my hair for a long, long time, and, you know, she died of a very aggressive and completely relentless cancer, and I sort of decided that at my age, it probably wasn't a good idea to keep dyeing my hair for another decade, since that pretty much is what killed her, was exposure to hair dye. So, I decided to grow out the gray, and I'm just going to go gray. But, you know, weird thing about hair is that, you know, when you've got the, you know, gray hair with black roots, it's like totally rocking, you know? Flip that look around, doesn't work so well. Just have to change the rules on that, you know? Can we go gray roots and black hair? So maybe if it gets long enough. I think maybe when it gets like eye length all the way around, it'll be a look. Sort of a Todd Rundgren type thing. That's it. I'm Fran in the lab. The Fran Lab. And I'll see you next time. Bye.